We are about to start the second panel discussion. Getting an effective technology from the lab to the patient in Europe, challenges and opportunities. I would like to invite to the stage Francois Ouillet, moderator of this session. Francois is a co-chair of the EUnetHTA Stakeholder Forum, and he's also director treatment information and access and health policy advisor at the European Rare Disease Organization, EURORDIS.
Thank you very much, Julia, and good afternoon to all. We have three important topics to discuss, so we will start immediately. I would like to invite the panel on the stage. So the panelists today, we have six for this session. Hans-Georg Eichler, who is the Senior Medical Officer at the European Medicines Agency. Hans-Georg, if you could join the scene, the stage. So Hans-Georg graduated from Vienna. He worked in several universities in the UK, Austria, US, worked, conducted some outcome research for industry, and now coordinates the activities of scientific committees at the EMA. Wolfgang Ecker, who is chairing the working group on clinical investigation and evaluation on medical devices from the European Commission, also from Vienna, and his competences in medical devices range from pharmaceuticals to medical devices, radiopharmaceuticals, and radio protection. Finn Borlum Christensen, whom you know, the director of the EUnetHTA Secretariat, and also professor of HTA at the University of Southern Denmark. François Meyer, advisor to the president of the French Haute Autorité de Santé, advisor for international affairs, and also board members of HTAI, and leading the SEED project, Shaping European Early Dialogues, and his competences cover pharmaceuticals, medical devices, diagnostics and complex interventions, and public health actions. Sebastian Geiser, the director of HTA on health economics and reimbursement at St. Jude Medical in Brussels, and representing ECOMED, the Medical Devices Industry Association. And James Anderson, the director of European Partnership at GSK. And James Anderson leads the engagement with EU payers, politicians, HT agencies. He worked on the first multi-country parallel advice, and he's currently also working on medicine adaptive pathways to patients. So welcome. This afternoon we'll have three topics, 30 minutes each, so we will have questions to the panel, and I will take questions from the floor as well, so please, you're invited to contribute to raise questions. To set the scene, I'd like to start with three examples where we think maybe the dialogue between regulators and HTA experts may have provoked some misunderstanding in the patient community. The first one, it's already an old one, from the 90s, in 96, when the anti-HIV products were introduced in Europe with a remarkable rapid regulatory action, some of them being evaluated in 59 days by the EMA. And then patients in countries which did not benefit from early compassionate use were waiting for the products to arrive. And we saw that in some countries, although it was probably the most effective medical intervention of the 20th century, in some countries, some were asking for cost economic assessment first before treating patients. And in other countries, it wasn't the cost and economic that were the problem, but more societal views, where even in Europe, some countries decided to cover the treatments for hemophiliacs and heterosexual persons infected by HIV, but not for homosexuals and injecting drug users who could benefit from the treatment, but thanks to the international cooperation, no thanks to the national decision to cover. which highlight the fact that the benefit risk is one thing, but there are other dimensions that need to be considered to ensure access to medicines. Another example, a bit more recent, with products to treat Alzheimer's disease. Some of them showed some indication of, they showed statistical difference and improvement in the cognitive functions and memory loss. But in some countries, after first deciding to cover the product, because the numbers needed to benefit, to be treated for one to benefit were too high, this decision was reversed, and then patients who had started treatment had to pay for the treatment, which created a lot of confusion among patients and families. Another example, a rare disease, Pompe's disease, where patients are treated with an enzyme replacement therapy with two different groups of patients, the early onset in children and the late onset in adults, where the benefits are not at all the same. And in this case, there was an interesting court case in Switzerland where they considered on one side the regulatory conclusions, which did not explicitly restrict the use to pediatric cases. And on the other hand, the payers who were explaining that because the benefit is completely different in adults, they decided not to reimburse the product in adults. And the debate also took place in other countries. In Netherlands, there was a public hearing to explain the HTA decision and explaining the benefit risk on one side, but the limitations of the product value for some patients. I think it's important to note the efforts of this CVZ in the Netherlands to have a public hearing. It's important to bring technologies to the public. It's also important to bring the information and the explanation of the regulatory and HTA decisions so that the public opinion can adhere to the respective decisions. There are many other examples in complex diseases or with complex technologies when it is not at all certain how to evaluate the medicine to start with or the medical device. You may have photos of the retina to show that anatomically the retina seems to be restored, but do the patients see better? How do you measure improved vision? This is a very tricky evaluation. The EMA organized a workshop, a scientific workshop, for example, on that topic. How do we assess that patients see better when they are treated? What does it mean? Can they read? Can they see the light or just the shapes? And this is also a field where HTA experts and regulators have to come together to propose ways to develop new technologies. So we'll have three main topics which appear on the screen for discussion this afternoon. And for each of these topics, we have other questions, but please don't hesitate to stand to take the floor if you have questions. The first relate to the life cycle of technologies. There are a good viewpoint, well, this viewpoint is useful to find approaches to align regulatory and HTA bodies. So the question is, how do we see that alignment happening? Is industry seeing an evolution? The second is on evidence generation before and after marketing authorization. So apart from the classical data collection from randomized clinical trials, what are the other sources of information that can serve both the needs of the regulators and HTA experts? And the third question is what needs to be done at the European and national level in terms of policy development. So the first question, if I can have the next slide, because I don't see the device to change the slide. Oops.
Can you read it?
Nope.
He's going to take other questions.
What? So I read out the three questions to the panel. So the first one, how do regulators and HTA consult each other when developing or revising guidelines or when engaging in parallel scientific advice or early dialogue with industry? The second question, when and what type of HTA, rapid or full comprehensive HTA, can be performed for medicines and medical devices, and how can this choice be aligned with the requirements and timelines of the regulatory process? And third question, for medicines, are European HTA organizations with possible support from the European Cooperation on HTA ready to deliver relative effectiveness assessment simultaneously with marketing authorization? So I'll invite the panelists to respond and to give concrete responses on what is actually happening and how things will are already changing and will change in the near future. So who would like to start addressing one of these three questions? So on early dialogues and then the Sebastian?
Yeah. I'm happy to take the one on the early dialogue. I think, and if I'm looking at all these people here today, I'm thinking the early dialogue we've been engaged in, or we are getting engaged in, is something I truly appreciate because I think it brings everybody out of their comfort zone. You suddenly, as industry, you have to face totally different questions and you have to face questions to HTA agencies that you probably didn't think of before. And think of our industry also being very focused on clinical. However, I think the link between clinical and HTA really comes to play when you have early dialogue. It allows you actually to bring everybody within the company to a table and say, we need to have a totally different dialogue than we had in the past. Because right now it used to be very simple. You would bring a product to the market and then you would sell it. But now you have to think in the context of patient pathways. You have to think in the context of who else do you need to partner with to make a technology not only sellable with a CE marking, but also really introduced into a market. And that makes a huge difference.
François?
Yeah. Yes, maybe to remind that early dialogue, the process of early dialogue is that the company comes and explains its plans for the development of a new technology and asks questions to the HTA bodies, for instance, on the choice of comparator, the choice of endpoints, the design of the study. And then HTA bodies, and within the frame of EUnetHTA, and now the so-called SEED project, it's multiple HTA bodies. Multiple HTA bodies are there. So give answers. So it provides the possibility for the company to have a feedback from HTA bodies and to try to make appropriate choices. And of course, it provides also the possibility to have a dialogue between HTA bodies because it is proven now after having performed more than 15 of these multi-HTA early dialogues, or about 15, 14 actually, that we can reach consensus in many cases. Not in all cases. We've taken this morning the example of some constraints on the choice of comparators that can come from legislative constraints that we cannot, HTA people do not make laws. So if it's not possible to take an off-label use of a drug as a comparator in one country, this cannot change. But we really can reach consensus in many cases, and it makes things clear and transparent for the company to make the choice. And now we are embarking in having a parallel early dialogues with the EMA, and that's of course a possibility for the company, for drugs, to know what regulators want and what HTA bodies want. So this is really promising and we are looking forward, and I don't know, we had the opinion from somebody from medical devices industry. Not all actors in medical device industry are very engaged in this activity because the HTA has not the same role for medical devices, not a similar role in every country as it is the case for drugs. But we are very happy to have some important players in this field being engaged now in this activity.
James Anderson.
Thanks. So GSK also has a number of experiences of the early dialogue process in different forms as it continues to evolve, I would say. And I think the reason that we are very supportive of this is clear. If we were trying to build a submarine or a warship, would we just build something and hope that it fitted with the people who wanted to buy it? No, I don't think so. Well, that takes 10 years. It involves hundreds of researchers and collaborations with all sorts of people inside and outside the company, as does drug development, right? So why should that be any different? Why it's just odd not to have processes like early dialogue. I wanted to share an experience that we had last year under the EUnetHTA program, where exactly we had this situation that a critical choice we needed to make for a phase three study was the choice of comparator. And it was for a disease where there was an approved product, but it wasn't used in most countries. And in fact, what was used was a wide variety of products off-label. And in fact, more complicated for us than that, in the States, it was the other way around, that the product that's approved in Europe is not approved, and the other way around. So we had different advice from FDA and EMA, and we went to a EUnetHTA dialogue, with this being the number one question, I would say. It was very helpful because we got a clear answer from the agencies involved, and that was, on the basis of that, we made a decision. However, I would like to see this evolve further, because what didn't happen was that there were some agencies, as we heard this morning, where the choice is not their preferred choice, right? So somehow we had to choose a comparator that won't fit perfectly for every agency. And now the company kind of has a choice there as well, right? So do we do another study with another comparator in order to deliver the data that's required by a few agencies in this case, or not? What I would like to see as this process continues to evolve is the ability to agree how do we bridge those kind of gaps.
Hans-Georg, yeah.
So I totally agree with everything my colleagues on the panel have said, but let me take it to a slightly broader level. And I'm grateful that you put the term life cycle at the very beginning of those questions. First, we have to be clear why we want to do that and what it means. There is a term that I hear sometimes from colleagues in my own regulatory environment, and I also hear it from HTA bodies, and that term is the complete data package. And every time I hear it, I cringe, because that is something that never existed and that will never exist. So expecting the complete data package and requesting it from technology developers is probably not a smart way forward. Given the complexities of modern technologies, our incomplete understanding of biology, and the unpredictability of how it is used and performs in real life, the only rational way to me seems to be to adopt this lifespan approach, which means that you take a decision based on a certain initial information, you reassess, you revise your decision, you broaden, you narrow, and dare I say, as a non-payer, you may even increase or decrease price and coverage. So that would be to me the only logical way forward in our complex environment. What would that mean for the interaction between payers and regulators and between HTAs and payers, etc.? It will mean that we will not meet once for the early dialogue, as much as I think this is the necessary first step, but that is not the last step. There have to be repeat interactions between those decision makers to achieve harmonized decision making. So having said that, what should we talk about? And that brings me to questions 2 and 3. And I think there are 3 themes where we have to talk. One is evidence standards. We've heard it already this morning, with the possible exception of the comparator, which has some reasonable grounding. But all these differences are historical accidents. That is not grounded in biology, that is not even grounded, as we have just heard, in different desires and preferences from patients. The preferences from patients are fairly uniform across Europe, so that is not a justification for one member state to say that we want this type of evidence and for the other we want that type of evidence. That's not there. So we have to, rather sooner than later, try to align those evidence standards to the extent possible. The second theme we have to talk about is timing. And again, We've heard it this morning from patients. Why do we have to wait so long? Some of this concerns the development and the regulatory stage, but some of this also concerns the gap between the regulatory and the payer coverage decision. Can we shrink that gap? Probably we can. There was a model coming out from the US FDA who spoke about parallel assessments with the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, which is the closest that the Americans have to what we have here in Europe. That was a model that has been put to use once or twice. It hasn't been used very often. But maybe in future we will come to that. Maybe that is a model. We are now talking about data sharing early on between the EMA and HTA bodies. I think that is the right way forward. We have to progress that, to shrink the gap, to enable HTA bodies to do what you have started in EUnetHTA with the rapid early relative efficacy assessment, etc. So that is the timing. And lastly, we have to have a serious debate about methodologies. And when I say methodologies, I mean two things. One is on your screen, the observational studies. We have to learn that the RCT is not the only silver standard. I'm not calling it a gold standard because it isn't. It is important, it is the best we have, but it's a silver standard and it will not be applicable to all questions that we need to ask. We have to come to grips with observational studies. And that is a common problem that we have in the regulatory and in the HTA community to make those meaningful and to interpret those right. And there is a second frontier now coming up, and I'm not sure it has dawned on everybody in this room, a huge opportunity. I know some colleagues in industry will not like to hear this, but the time of data sharing, open trial data, etc. is here. And it is now here for summer reports. We have started this. There is European legislation. This train will move to sharing of patient-level data. It will not be an easy journey, but it will happen. And that will open a huge opportunity for people who do early relative effectiveness or efficacy assessment, excuse me. Because the wish that we will have, as you just said, for each and every comparator, we will have an active controlled RCT, that is a pipe dream. That cannot happen. Because the opportunity cost for that is so high that it doesn't make sense. What you can use is those indirect comparisons. I envisage a world where we will have the patient level data from all these studies shared, and then you can do relatively quick and relatively easy comparative studies. And that I see as the future, that our next frontier to discuss.
Thank you.
Finn?
Yeah, I would like to very briefly go into the issue you also raised about guidelines. We actually have a mechanism when it comes to guidelines on drugs where the EMA, although you can also go to the website and see it, but the EMA is actually updating EUnetHTA on a regular basis on guidelines that are on their way into public consultation. And they have in a couple of instances actually asked EUnetHTA to pay particular interest. We may not always have done the joint work in responding, for example, because for one reason that, I mean, we may be fully booked already with things to do in EUnetHTA, and that's one thing. Another thing is that it might actually be difficult to do anything else than collecting the views of partners on, for example, the choice of outcome measure. And we would not be able to develop a EUnetHTA position simply looking at the discrepancies that we currently could see. So we need to keep in mind again that we are moving ahead in a network of voluntary participating organizations. That said, we are also doing guidelines work, and maybe we can come back to that later. François can say more about this, but we are doing guidelines on also areas that are not pharmaceuticals, like systematic review and assessment of diagnostic tests, and also some work on non-randomized evidence. So again, we also need to remember that we are not only dealing with drugs, but also with other interventions, including the devices. And coming to devices, I remember Henry Kissinger when he was Secretary of State many years ago, during the 70s, he had a comment about Europe. He said, who do you call in Europe? And what he meant was, if you want to have a European view on something, it was not possible to go anywhere for that. He would need to call all the different countries' capitals to get the view. And not bringing that comparison further, but when you look at the area of what is sometimes called non-pharmaceutical, the non-pharmaceutical area, which is in itself is quite an interesting thing. I mean, we have the pharmaceuticals and then we have the rest. But in that area, who do we go to when it is about devices at this time? We don't see a single coordinator of regulation at this time from point of view of EUnetHTA. So that is giving an extra challenge. There is a new legislation on the way, but it's still going to be very, I think, decentralized. And that will also need to be taken into account.
Before Wolfgang, I have a question, Finn. You did not mention the disease-specific guidelines that EUnetHTA
yep.
is now starting to work on. And the
That's
EMA
correct.
Also has guidelines for disease-specific on how to evaluate.
Yeah, there's, what, there's a work on its way on disease-specific guidelines. It's actually on osteoarthritis. So I guess osteoarthritis, again, is not only about drugs, but also about other things. And it is a work on the way, and surely we will also be listening very carefully to the feedback that we could get from EMA and regulators. And in this process of making it, attention is also paid to the already existing disease-specific guidelines developed by the EMA.
And regarding the involvement of all stakeholders in defining these guidelines, if you could comment or what is planned?
I will hand this over to Work Package 7.
I'm Work Package 7, okay, part of. And call me Work Package 7. Okay. And of course, there is a consultation of stakeholders, as we have in EUnetHTA, with the usual approach, so that the group of stakeholders that have declared a particular interest in the field, the stakeholders advisory groups, would be consulted first, and also, of course, the EMA and other. And then there will be at the end a public consultation, of course, on these disease-specific guidelines. We have one project. It is important, I think, to have this disease-specific approach in complement to the product-specific approach that we have with early dialogues. So that's something that I hope we will can continue to develop in the future joint actions.
Okay. Wolfgang Ecker, if you would like to respond.
Yes, in the. Can I be heard?
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah.
Sure. Thank you. In the device sector, of course, our regular problem is that the CE marking is very fast. And if member states are examining costly technologies or high-risk technologies later on to decide on bringing it to the healthcare systems, I would say more than half of all cases these devices are considered as still experimental, and it is recommended to, let us say, put them again back to the stage of clinical investigations. And I think this is a situation which is really not good, and it must be more seamless and predictable. So I think this kind of early dialogues where we have only very few experience up to now, this is something for the future, will help us, especially the manufacturers, when developing their clinical evaluation plans to go the optimal way, so to have a more seamless transition both to CE marking and to reimbursement. This is, of course, valid for the costly and high-risk devices. The other devices normally go without HTA assessment. Specifically with regard to this staged evidence generation, as Hans-Georg has mentioned, this is also valid, of course, for the devices. If we have new implants, or new hip implants, we cannot wait 10 years until we have real long-term data on that. We have to find a way to, let us say, to have a market access after all the necessary technical, preclinical, and the first clinical experiences. But we need the commitment of a post-market clinical follow-up, which is also agreed and must be planned. here's again a room for, let us say, some not early, but also some kind of scientific advice. So to go in the right direction to allow for proper evaluation of the long-term performance and effectiveness of these implants. This is desperately needed for the sake of patients. We cannot wait in Europe until a serious problem like the MOMs or some other implants is hitting European grounds with more than 100,000 patients affected. We have to clearly stage this evaluation process. And here's also room both for the notified bodies and the regulators and the HTA people for the proper methodology of reading registry data. We have heard today several opinions on registries, on their long-term, let us say, data delivery. Some have been quite skeptical. I have been more enthusiastic thinking of one of the Swedish registries on coronary stents where they have, where they can control more than 200 variables out of the Swedish healthcare system. I think this is quite a new scientific entity we have to consider in future. These high quality registries and I think we in the device sector we have to strongly rely on that and start with some pilot projects on the one side to create really good registries and on the other side to have, let us say, annual or biannual evaluations together with the scientific societies and HTA people to detect suspect low and very low performers as early as possible.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to ask the audience to take the floor to raise questions. I have a first one maybe while you are thinking or preparing your question. For rapid HTA assessment in time with a regulatory decision, are we ready to deliver as many rapid reports as needed? And in parallel, we have the rapid assessment for medical devices. And if not, what is needed? What are the resources needed to, for maybe this year, there were 60 new medicines authorized by the EMA. Is there a systematic need for a rapid HTA report for all of them? If not, on which criteria is it decided to have that? How is this organized?
Yes, I would like maybe to try to clarify things, because if I read the questions here on this topic, there is the life cycle, we have a good viewpoint in finding approach to aligning regulatory and HTA requirements. And then the last question is, are HTA bodies ready to deliver relative effectiveness assessments simultaneously with marketing authorization? Now, if we align the requirements and provide our reports at the same time, it means that it's not two separate processes, but one single one. And there we are misleading if we make people believe that, because the two processes are and will remain separated because they do not have the same purposes. They do not have, they do not answer to the same questions, EMA evaluating quality, safety, efficacy, and looking at the benefit-risk ratio, and HTA body looking at what is the magnitude in health gain that this product will give in a real-life situation, and how does that compare with other compounds. So it's a totally different question, and it is normal that we do not reach exactly the same conclusion, and you can get a yes for the EMA and a no for from a HTA body. And then again, there is something that we should not believe, that sort of science is objective and universal, and what makes the differences here, silly subjective judgments that have nothing to do with science and that are not tolerable. It's not tolerable to have differences among countries, but things are different because among science you come to, there is a scientific judgment that where people have to decide in front of the same data whether these data are relevant and significant or not, and this is a judgment. So if you ask various bodies, committees to answer to this question, they will give different answers. And as we have different, as things are decided at member state levels,
there are different committees and they will reach in front of the same data, they may reach different consequences. So unless you have a unique healthcare system in Europe with a unique HTA body and a unique decision maker, you will have differences, and that's something that cannot and will not be overcome. What we try to do is to reduce and to avoid the differences that are not justified by the fact that the judgments are taking into account the local culture, consideration, financial possibilities, whatever you want. There will be differences, but there are some differences that we can avoid. And this is all the work we are trying to do within EUnetHTA and working together between EUnetHTA and HTA bodies. So you know how many, so okay, it's important to know how many rapid HTA reports we can produce, but HTA, how many HTA rapid common assessment we can produce, but do not believe that because we have common assessment reports for all products, we will have common conclusions, appraisal, and decisions at the member state level, because there are some freedom that remain for a member state to decide on what should be put in their healthcare system. So that's something I think was important to say, to have a right picture. Doesn't mean that we should not cooperate and that we will not have very concrete achievements, but do not expect what cannot be reached because of just what I said.
Yes. Okay, very short comment, and then we take questions.
I'll be very short. I mean, about the actual question, about the timing, anything that can be done by the EMA, the regulators, on the medicines again, and the biologics, and the companies, to make the information available so that we can actually start our work and do our rapid relative effectiveness assessments while the regulators are finalizing their work. Anything that can be done to make that easier will make it easier for us to come out relatively quickly after. It's unrealistic, and this is also a question to industry, but we also need to have the questions from the audience. I mean, are you willing to share the information before you have the opinion of the CHMP?
Questions from the audience, yes. Can you introduce yourself, please?
Yeah, I'm Paolo Borghese from Europa Bio. So first of all, it's really to reinforce the idea that early dialogue, scientific advice is a very important step and is considered crucial by biotech industry. My question is related to point three, mainly. So we have heard this morning and also during this session about some challenges, let's say, coming in harmonizing or giving a unique or univocal or consistent advice in the early dialogue phase, and some of them being related to, you know, differences among countries and different laws, François, you mentioned. And this lead, you know, in some cases also coming to James' example, to very tough decision on the industry side, because if you have, I don't know, four or five different requirements in terms of comparators or primary endpoints, you will have to choose between one, maximum two. So you don't have, you know, infinite amount of resources. You have industry, as everybody has to make rational decisions, so you will choose one or two. So on your side, do you think that there could be done something at national level to change current law, to change current requirements, to change processes? So to identify things that are not necessarily, you know, related to constraints that, you know, that are a priority for the country. So something that you can identify things that can be changed without maybe not disrupting the healthcare system or the healthcare organization at national level. So are there things that are there and they are different just because that was how they have been developed over time, and there is kind of inertia, you know, something that maybe could be changed?
I think it's the vast question about revisiting the standard of care in each country, and the question also of obsolete technologies. Who would like to address very shortly to respond?
The exercise of early dialogues is very typical of showing the fact that by having to answer the same question together at the same time and being sure that we have time to allow exchanges between HTA bodies is proved to be very good at making us able to change, because we, in the process of early dialogues, the company sends a list of questions, then we have draft answers from every HTA body participating that are compiled and distributed to all partners, and then we have a teleconference and then a face-to-face meeting between HTA bodies, and we discuss together. An individual from HTA body that you have heard this morning, that you will meet here or that are working in the agency, discuss, and they can change their point of view, and we can reach consensus, if not in all cases, in many cases. So it's clear that this cooperation makes possible to have a convergence in not all, but many points, and to have things evolving. That's for the HTA process. Now for the regulatory frames that may vary from a country to another, it's another story, of course.
Sebastian, rapidly.
Yeah. Yep. I think on the early dialogue, there's one thing which is a little bit difficult for companies, because you mentioned earlier that not everybody was so fond of early dialogue. And it has to do that you get the early dialogue with HTA agencies. Let's assume we also do the early dialogue with regulatory. Who's not around the table at the end of the day and barely here in the room are payers. So you do all these things and you have a CE marking then, and then you may even have a positive HTA, but there is no clear impact in a lot of countries that this would actually lead to a payment. So you may do all this work, and I'm thinking for a company maybe having a lot of products and being a little bit risky in what they do, they may say, well, I have a product portfolio where I can do this, and there will be some products which I will be successful with. Others I may lose. If I'm thinking of companies that are not our size or not the size of GSK, I would assume that it's a hard thing for them to do, because it's simply hard for them to predict whether they're ever going to be successful with this. And I think this is a core difference between pharmaceutical products and medical devices, that we do not have any possibility to predict whether any payer will be willing to pay for that. I had a very funny discussion the other day in one country where I thought this is really striking me. So we have CE marking and we have clinical trials. There's even an RCT, and this payer says to us, they want to see FDA clearance. So things become a little bit absurd in a way if we have everything in place, right? And then somebody says, well, I changed my criteria right now because in the background I don't have money. So in the future for high-risk devices, I would like to see FDA clearance, and this in Europe. And that makes it, I think, very difficult for us, and especially for companies, to get engaged in these processes. I'm positive about them because I think at some point of time we have to bring the payer to an early dialogue and then get also an early commitment from them.
Thank you. We take two more questions from the floor. Pauline, please.
Yes, it's working. Pauline Evers, patient representative from Cancer Patient Organization in the Netherlands. I have a question about the daily practice data, because we are talking about setting up registries for various diseases. And I think registries originate from the rare disease area where you have a limited amount of patients, a limited amount of treatment centers, maybe one or two medicinal products involved. And even there, it's quite difficult to set up in the European registry. In the Netherlands, we have set up a registry in melanoma patients, because recently some products have been registered there, and we would like to have the real-life data comparing these products against each other. There are 800 patients. We have centralized the treatment of these patients in 12 hospitals, but still setting up a registry for this was quite a time-consuming and also expensive exercise. And the reason for that is that the way within the hospitals the data are putting into a system, that is different. I can tell you we have about a little bit less than 100 hospitals in the Netherlands, but each hospital has its own ICT system. So if you would like to have patients in a registry, you cannot just simply extract data from these 100 different systems. You really need to type in a lot of the data again into the registry. This is 800 patients in 12 hospitals for melanoma. We are now thinking of the new products which are coming along for lung cancer, and then we are talking about 10,000 patients, and they will be treated in all of those 99 hospitals in the Netherlands. And we think it's really hardly impossible to set up a register for that in the Netherlands. And what we actually would like to do is maybe set up this throughout Europe. So I was just wondering what the vision of the panel is about for more common diseases, how we could ever assemble these data in the registers, who will be responsible, and how we can set a common standard or some system that we can easily extract the data from the hospital files.
So the next topic will be on observational studies. So we'll come back to your question in the next topic. Last question from Yann Lecam.
Yann Lecam, Chief Executive of EUorders. In fact, I realized today going in the room that there is a quite large delegation of patients representatives and experts from the field of rare disease and orphan drugs. And that's, there is a reason for that, is that we have major challenges of access with huge differences from one country to another. And we have robust expectation of what HTA 2.0 can deliver. So my question is the following, is that when we hear the presentations of this morning, particularly of Mr. Guido Razzi from EMA, followed by Hans-Georg in the panel, excellent intervention, thank you. And when we hear both of them, we believe into that. When we hear Finn presenting the strategy and the vision of HTA 2.0, we believe into that. Now, when we listen to the panel of HTA agencies, that becomes a bit more complex. There is some, let's say, conservatism and defense of the remit of the responsibilities. So now I'm trying to find a way of how is that going to apply for us. Small populations is really the area where life cycle product is essential, when continuum of evidence generation is essential. Small population, it's orphan drugs, rare disease treatments, pediatric use of medicines, advanced therapies. My question to the panel is, how are you going in real life in the coming years really to apply that in the area of small populations? We are the victims of the current fragmentations of HTA. It's nonsense to discuss with 28 agencies and to collect data on 5 patients or 10 patients. You need to collaborate. We need the evidence to have the good use of medicines and the optimal allocation of resources, not to be also the victims of the non-reimbursement because we don't have the data. So you can change that. You can change that with horizon scanning and early dialogue. You can change that by adaptation of the core HTA model to small population, and you can change that with rapid assessment for all rare disease and orphan drug products and other pediatric use of medicines. So are you ready to do it?
Who would like to respond? Finn?
I think we would be willing to go this way. We have piloted our ways in applications on broader indications than orphan indications. And we have it sort of on the back burner that we should also go into the area of orphan diseases. It may actually then be something that could make a stronger case for a European approach. I think you should test this with the HTA network, the strategic network for the HTA cooperation in Europe, because there are methodological, technical issues of it, that's UNETHTA, and then there are the issues of how does it fit into policy and what are the policy needs. So if you can make a strong case to the strategic policy level, then we could go this way. It seems to be an area where it would make sense because orphan drugs, orphan areas have already been identified to be closer to something European than for big diseases like diabetes, etc.
Yeah, I think talking about orphan drugs or treatments for rare disease, because they are not only drugs, let's think about, if you take the European regulation on orphan medicine products voted in 2000, it is clearly stated that patients affected by rare diseases not only have the right to get access to treatments, but they have the right to get access to treatments with the same level of efficacy, safety, etc., than other patients. And that due to that, these products should go through the same process of evaluation than other products. So we have to find a solution that is a good balance between the fact that we have to take into consideration limitations for getting information in very small populations, difficulties when we do not know the natural history of the disease and so on, and the fact that patients do not deserve to have treatments that have the same level of efficacy and so on than other treatments. So that's something that you should never, never forget. You, patient organizations, health professional, everybody, we should have the right path that is not very easy to find. Then we should not always claim that there is a specific situation that is, for instance, rare diseases, and we should not think into silos, because, for instance, we are at HTA bodies dealing also with medical devices, and quite often medical devices deal with small population as well. So we can have some common point of views on what are the specificities for that. And with regard to the fact that there is some conservatism whatsoever, come on, it is a voluntary cooperation. We have 28 member states participating, a high number of agencies, I don't remember the exact numbers, and if not, not all of them participate in all the various actions we have, but all of them are active in some or the other parts of the actions. And with it, for instance, the first early dialogues, parallel early dialogues we had with the EMA within the SEED project, it was on an orphan drug for a very rare disease. So things are progressing. There may be some limitations that will take time to be decreased, but really things are already happening. And I think this can only get better in the future.
So two last comments and or responses. Sebastian first, you had, no? So Hans-Georg, and then we move to the next topic. Hans-Georg.
Okay, well, first, thanks to Jan for throwing down the challenge to us. And for reminding us about the importance of the rare diseases. I think most of us would agree that the future is in rare diseases. And as stratified medicine takes off, and it does, slower than predicted, but it does, the future is exactly in those fields. We will be dealing with smaller treatment-eligible populations in future. That is a fact. So how can we put real-world data to use? And Pauline, you told us why the glass is half empty. And I agree with everything you said. I would even add there is another obstacle to using those data. You talked about the practical difficulties, the data generation. There is another difficulty in the data interpretation, and we have heard it this morning, that observational non-randomized data are inherently sort of dubious. All true. But then let me tell you why the glass is half full. First, 5 years ago, we would not have the data, real-life data, that we have today. We're in the midst of a journey, and that journey is actually accelerating. The day will come soon when the last prescription for a drug will be written by a doctor by pen and paper. It will all be, if it isn't already, I don't know, all be electronic. All these data are out there somewhere on a server. They can be put to use. And that raises the next question about data quality and data governance. If you want a role model for where we could go, there is one on this planet. It's called the Sentinel Initiative by the FDA. I'm always impressed what they can do. They had exactly the same starting point. A load, and the American fragment, the American healthcare market is even more fragmented than the European. Let's not fool ourselves. We think we are fragmented. If you really want atomized market, go to the United States. Yeah, there is 2,000s and thousands of payers, decision makers, etc. They managed to get off the ground the mini Sentinel model. They do not share the data. They share algorithms. They share research questions, and the data come back. So they are successful. They're leading the way. Can we copy that? Absolutely yes. And if there is a will. And the last thing is about the methodology. And that is what I addressed earlier on. Yes, of course, non-randomized data, or what some call observational data, have their weaknesses. There's no secrets here. But there are also ways to try to address those. Maybe they will not be perfect, but they will enable us to answer well-specified research questions. And to put them to use, to inform future rounds of regulatory or HTA decisions.
So let's continue on observational studies and evidence generation. So first question to regulators, how do you use or see the use of these data? What are the recent initiatives or new approaches that have been launched or are being discussed? So both for pharmaceuticals and medical devices industry, if you have also your point to express about it. Jim?
So I'm happy to go first. And I think this actually builds very nicely on the last conversation about rare diseases and small patient populations. So, so again, I'll start with an example. We have a product for lupus, which is a disease that's highly heterogeneous. It's not rare, but it's not very common. And designing the clinical studies was quite challenging for this one. Again, there's no clear comparator. It's treated in many different ways, etc. We did the studies and had approval, and then we're still working through in some countries, four years after approval, to get access. In the meantime, we have been gathering observational data. One of the things that lupus patients are treated with is high doses of steroids over a prolonged period of time. We all know this is not good for anybody. So in the clinical program, however, we had to control the steroid use, so it was impossible to see whether there was a reduction in the need for steroids over time. That is something that we have been able to do through gathering real-world data. And we now have, we're starting to get a clear signal out of that data, and it's positive, right? So this, I think, comes back to exactly the question of how can we use that data now that we have it to, let's say, cross the finish line in those countries where we still haven't even launched the product, make it available to patients. But probably even more than that, if we turn the clock back 3, 4, 5 years, how could we have had the conversation back then to say, we will develop this data, it's going to take 3, 4, 5 years, but can we find an agreement that we can make the product available now on the basis that that data will come? That for me is where this HTA 2.0 and the collaborative approach can really create a winning opportunity that patients will benefit from.
I think it's worth noticing that tomorrow is the last day to comment on the EMA consultation on a new approach for registries. And the EUnetHTA also has on its work plan to work on observational data. So there will be more developments to come here. Do you think there are common needs and possibilities to have registries both for pharmaceuticals and medical devices, or are these completely different questions, research questions or settings which would justify different processes?
I think from industry perspective on medical devices, I think it would be excellent to have actually a pilot, maybe to convince Dr. Lange, who said he wasn't convinced of registries, maybe we could do a pilot where we bring payers, HTA agencies, regulatory bodies, industry, and patients around the table and structure a registry and structure define what kind of criteria is acceptable for everybody. In a sense of, I would assume that maybe regulatory and HTA have different parameters they would like to see in registries, to actually run it on one of the large disease areas, because I think it would be fruitful to do that so we really see the impact of what registry can show. Because I fully agree with you, there seems to be always this observational study is so bad and it's not really helping us, but I think if you look at the large registries as mentioned earlier by Wolfgang, if you look at cardiovascular diseases and if you look at orthopedics, this is so valuable to have, and it's actually one of the regulatory purposes as an early warning system, for example. So I think it would be good if we think of the collaboration we could go into right now that you're proposing actually through your position paper. I think it would really make sense to think into the direction of registries, because that's very concrete and it's something that tackles everybody around the table.
Hans Georg?
Well, on this registries, and is there a difference between devices and medicines? once again, what are the challenges when you look at real-world data? It is data quality, it is governance, and it is methodology. I would challenge anybody in this room to tell me what the differences are, whether you're looking at a pharmaceutical or at a device. The methodological challenges, whether there is confounding by indication or channeling bias, whatever you call that, they're the same. So do I see in the long run a great difference between those two? My personal answer, I may be wrong, is no. Also, I would say this whole debate that we are having about registries today, that is a stepping stone, that is an intermediate solution. The future in any advanced civilized healthcare system will be electronic health records that will be more and more complete, that will be more and more talking to each other because of technology that is evolving. And we will not in 10 years' time set up registries every time a new drug or device comes to market. We will harness the existing electronic health records to answer questions. So once we are there, I think that difference between the two types of products will evaporate.
Wolfgang Eckert, you wanted to respond?
Yes, I think this is one of the things which seems to be partly already realized in some of the Swedish registries. So they really have a grasp on over 200 variables, at least for the coronary stents. And I already told, I think this is quite some new kind of scientific entity, which is to be really compared to our most advanced clinical trials. With regard to the proposal to have some pilot projects, yes, we are negotiating, or at least in an early stage of trying to have some pilots for the Parent 2 project. The Parent 1 has been very, let us say, theoretical and methodologically oriented. And this is quite obvious a necessity because it's quite tricky to read the registries really and to attribute low performances and outcomes and address them to pharmaceuticals or certain kind of devices. So we would like to have some starting projects at European level, which should be funded by the Commission, with the help of some member states and clinical societies and HTA people. And there will also be more than some kind of a pilot, a cooperation at international level. This is an initiative called IMDRF, International Medical Device Regulators Forum, comprising more or less all the major blocks of the Western world together with the BRIC countries and WHO as observers, and they have recently agreed on a project called MedEpinet, which is dealing with methodological questions for registries in the medical device area. It's mainly led by FDA and some US universities and would integrate this open for all stakeholders. And Europe has agreed to that project and will likely cooperate on that international activity. So I think there will be progress.
So Sebastian and Geiser and then Finn.
One quick reaction to that. I turned the page this morning on the paper that you had signed off everybody yesterday, and I read on the second page that payers, patients, and industry were limited to being observers. And I think if we run another pilot on things, there is a true need not to make people observers and stakeholders, but active participants. Because you can sense from the attention that HTA is getting from physicians because they are just stakeholders and observers, that they are not active in the HTA arena. They are not active. I just heard from one agency today that they are not active in participating in HTAs. They say industry should respond to that and not physicians. I think if we keep saying that people are observers and stakeholders, they would limit themselves to it. And some may be outstanding. They may take a role more active. But in generally, all these associations will not be active as long as they are just observing and being a stakeholder.
Ways of engaging stakeholders is part of the governance. And I think this is also a domain where we are learning how to involve stakeholders in the various procedures. Finn?
Yeah, I would really like to follow up on that because in my country, Denmark, the clinicians, the providers were very, very active in developing clinical databases. They were then transformed into quality databases, and they were actually then more or less also in the hands of those that are running the healthcare system. So the employer, you could say the payer of the clinicians, would actually be in support of this kind of databases, say a database on hernia or a database on hip replacements or in cardiology, etc. So you need to have the providers quite close. And so they were not mentioned very much until now. It was just mentioned by Sebastian. They're very, very important. And again, several have mentioned the payers. Obviously, the payers need to back this kind of work so that it is seen as a part of the actual clinical work to also do a limited but still relevant registration of what is going on. This is the way future, together with all the big data that the electronic patient records, etc., can get to us. But the clinical databases will be much more refined than the general clinical medical record will be. So we need to also combine these things. This is being done in Denmark, and generally the Nordic countries are known to have good registers and disease-specific or other databases. And for the patient organizations, I would say, make sure that you really back on all this discussion about data protection, then it will still be possible to do clinical research and to do research on registers and what goes on in healthcare. Do support that we do not end in a situation where, do support that we avoid getting into a situation where the doctors will be told not to do a recording of this kind of data.
Can I ask in the audience who else would have had some experience with observational studies or registries among all different types of stakeholders, healthcare professionals, patients, payers, industry? Anyone who would like that? Can you please stand to the microphone, please, and say who you are?
Thank you. I'm Jacques Dehaller. I'm Vice President of CPME, of the Doctors of Europe. I'm afraid I'm not going to answer exactly your question, François. I was wanting to react to what has been said just before about doctors and observers and being part of HTA or only spectators or observers. I think doctors are very willing to be part of HTA, to be more than spectators or observers. The fact is that as doctors, there are two possibilities. We are very interested in HTA as specialists because it goes about innovation, treating patients with new medications, new devices, etc. And we're also very much interested in HTA as doctors of our patients. I mean, just to treat them, to give them the best, most adequate treatment possible, which means participating in HTA for doctors is not always discussing very technical, very scientific points, but also remembering that during the whole process and all stakeholders in the process, that HTA is about patients, about the ethics of HTA, about all these questions which are not hard facts, but soft questions, soft facts, which for us are quite central to HTA. So with this in mind, we definitely are very willing to be actively implicated in HTA.
Yeah, I would like to react on that. I think, yes, of course, and I think that HTA has to be done with the participation, not as observers, but as experts or of health professionals, of patients, of other involved parties, and that HTA takes into account the evidence through the literature survey and taking into account the data submitted by companies, but also the opinion of
expert and interested parties. And then finally, there is a committee in charge of taking everything into consideration, propose conclusions, and of course the participation there is not as an observer. So sometimes there is participation as an observer, but the general situation is that there is a direct involvement. And just to say about this question of registries or observational data, that what we are talking about is, yes, not specifically registries, it was mentioned by Hans-Georg, and we have all sorts of observational data that are interesting, databases, whatsoever, electronic patient records, and so on. And this is one of the activities of EUnetHTA as well, to try to coordinate the request for additional evidence generation for technologies for which there is a need for such an evidence, additional data collection. You've got the poster whatsoever outside, and of course this will be also a topic for cooperation. It is listed in the work plan of the EUnetHTA EMA cooperation to work on this question, not only for registries of course, but for all type of observational data we may need at the time of the initial assessment.
Wolfgang?
Yes. Yes. Several scientific societies during the last months have approached the medical device system in the EU and have offered their help either in drafting guidance and in trying to solve problems. So we are very grateful for that offer and of course, eager to include them in the device panels and expert panels to improve the system, and the same will hopefully be true for the HTA experts. So I think this is a really important step, echoing what Finn has said at the starting of this conference, to look at synergy, to go together with stakeholders in a broader sense. I think this is absolutely important, together with the patients and other, not just stakeholders, but people concerned about the efficiency of the systems.
So two last questions on observational studies, and then we move to the policy discussion. You had a question, maybe? No? So.
Yes. That's the comment Matthias Kajstedt from Sweden. So we're happy with some of the registries we have, but coming back to the suggestion before about making trials, there is a registry in stroke. It has 76 countries and it generates really high quality data. It's the same platform that's been used for RCTs as well, so the data quality is really high. So there are models how this really can be done with really high quality and also low cost. So I think it's important to pick up this opportunity and see how this can be done for different disease areas.
Any other question or comment? Yes, two, right here, first.
I also wanted to answer directly the question about registry. So my experience is on the UK regulator, the Committee for Safety of Devices, and England has a very good joint registry for hip implants, and that has helped us identify hip implants which we can recommend and not recommend. But the challenge for us was around collaboration even within the UK. So we have an English registry and we have a Scottish registry. The Scottish registry is too small to be able to do anything with, but we could not even collaborate across those registries because they had been designed by clinicians. And I think the most important thing for me is to understand how we can collaborate over the registries to make sure that we're not just getting national registries, but we are making the most of that information to be able to understand how we can optimize the utilization of these products, and that's what we need in the life cycle.
So there is a lot of policy development that needs to address these specific issues. One more question. Can you stand to the microphone or please?
Thank you for everything said today. There are two or three things actually that I want to give as a thought with you. I'm as a patient organization and also a multi-stakeholder at APOSI. we see that the ICT environment is actually working very fast on standards and interoperability of all kinds of ecosystems, and never think about an HTA or whatever. So the thing that I heard before, that data, and we should really think about who is the intellectual property owner of data, and that's the patients, according to Europe. And the second thing is, if you're going to see that all the new economies like Google and Amazon and stuff, they are all making their money with knowledge, and actually to make more worth of knowledge, as you actually with your HTA are doing, how are you going to see, or how are you going to regulate that with a governance if you're not even talking about what happens in other ecosystems? Like for 2 weeks I was in Torino, also by the Italian presidency, there was the small, medium and enterprises were talking together about nanotechnologies, making a lot of data. So the data that is collected by the patients is coming into all this nanotechnology. And they were talking there all about technical things, but no one of the healthcare system or of the HTA was there. And now I'm here, and I hear everyone talk about the HTA and about patients and stuff like that, but no one here is saying anything about what's happening in the ICT environment. So is the HTA having this awareness, and are you joining up, for example, in America, in, I only heard just now, into this, let's say, standardization in the ICT, because this is actually de facto then the interoperability between multi-stakeholders that is going to be the standard. And if we are not there as a group, as we are here, then we are actually limited to that what is actually thought and put into place at the ICT level.
So two questions, data ownership and the evaluation of ICT instruments. Who would like to address these questions? Volkan?
Yeah. Yes, thank you. I can only partly, of course, respond to that. Of course, there is a lot of standardization ongoing with regard to ICT also in healthcare. To have common interfaces and interoperability of systems. And of course this has also been recognized as a prerequisite of using registry data. So one of the elements of the new regulation, for example, will be the unique device identifier UDI system, also in Europe, which is now starting in the US, and we will have a worldwide system on that. So to really have a certain kind of data quality, we are sure we are talking about the same devices or about the same technologies or kinds of devices. The other thing with regard to ICD, of course, is a future challenge also for the HTA institutions. You will have to consider that a lot of the health-related apps will be considered in future as medical devices. So, and we are currently thinking of how to integrate that into the system, not only in Europe, but also worldwide. So that's an interesting challenge. I don't know whether there is already an HTA, a rapid assessment about several apps.
Well, I could follow up a bit on this. Well, actually, we are entering into a pilot on telemedicine in the area of chronic heart disease. And we are happy to also know that in this area of development of information and communication technology, the EU has actually been supporting a lot of projects. And what we heard yesterday in the HTA network was actually people from that environment saying that for the first 10 years we were more or less asked ourselves to do the evaluation of the things we developed, and they found that was unsustainable, and so they contacted decision makers, what would they like to know in evaluations on ICT, And then out of that came something that fitted quite well with the HTA core model. So there were some people who were involved in HTA and knew about EUnetHTA, and so they developed something called the MSAT, the MAST model, which is very much a model shaped on the HTA core model. So they have a broad approach of assessment. So we're going to, of course, make sure that when we move into this, we will get their experiences. And we know that we need to work also on these ICTs from HTA. They will have much more organizational emphasis than looking at a drug, for example. But it will be more like devices, that often devices will also call for a broader evaluation than the first four domains of the HTA core model, going into organization, for example, of healthcare. But so I could just say that, well, it's ongoing work, piloting at this time, because we don't have the methodologies in place.
Hans-Georg.
So thank you to the gentleman here for the question. Is the health sector, and I use all of us here in this, the health sector making the best possible use of the emerging ICT solutions? And the answer is probably no. We have room for improvement. That is, that's probably a given. But I want to end this on a positive note. And I was smiling when I heard about England and Scotland. That is a very special case. I mean, and Europe is broader. So maybe we can harmonize better than that. And to draw also your attention to existing initiatives, we know as a regulator, I'm now speaking as EMA here, we knew that we have that challenge of having one database sitting here, another one there, and another one there. And our approach was to bring those together in a network that we call NCEP, that is also a journey that is now underway, that has made progress, but we have not arrived where we want to arrive. I know that EUnetHTA has also embarked on a very broadly similar initiative. Can we bring these initiatives somehow to collaborate? The answer is probably yes, and we should, and we will debate this. So there is a lot of movement, and there is a lot of movement in the right direction.
Thank you. And as there is a lot of movement and many efforts and initiatives, we have to think about their sustainability from now. Else we will have excellent pilot, excellent experiences, but then the issue of how do we continue, how do we do it on a larger scale will continue to be a problem. And I propose we move to the third topic, which is on the needs to be done, what needs to be done at the policy level, but both European and national, to support even more cooperation between regulators and HTAs. So the three questions I would have to the panelists: what is the progress and future plans of the cooperation between EMA and EUnetHTA? What are the opportunities for cooperation with HTAs concerning medical devices? And what are the lessons learned from the European cooperation experience in rapid HTAs and early dialogues on medical devices? And if you would like to expand on other needs and policy proposals, please do so. And I also invite, as we have representatives from the European Commission, if they want to address the policy needs, you're welcome. So
I'm happy to start. I think in the last question, I'm a little bit surprised how the conversation played out, because I was thinking we'd be focused on how can the balance of evidence generation before and after marketing help us all together enable access earlier for patients, right? That's, you know, I think we didn't really come back to that. We talked about technologies, we talked about data, we talked about challenges. And so I think, well, what do we have? Well, we have the adaptive licensing pilot of the EMA launched, and this is, I think, is a very welcome step. I've been involved in some of the discussions at NewDigs and elsewhere that has contributed to the shaping of that, together with colleagues on the panel. And it's been a process that really has now delivered us into a place where we are trying to do something new together. So the now if we come to the, and it's trying to do exactly what I think is right, which is finding the most efficient way to develop new drugs and get them to patients. So do we need, what policy changes do we need? I think at the European level, in order to do that via a MAPS process or an adaptive licensing process, at the moment, from industry, from GSK perspective, we don't see any need for a policy change at a European level. We are involved in the pilot program, and it is early days, and I think we're all learning together. I don't think anyone would say that we know exactly how this will play through, but right now, I think we can all be really optimistic about this one. What I think I can foresee, and this has come up already, is where there are, at a national level in places, legislation that really restricts the flexibility that different stakeholders have, particularly in some cases the HTA stakeholders, to enable that earlier access. And we've talked about the comparator issue. For me, it is a good one, it's not the only one. I thought also Guido Rassi's slide about the surrogates and the use there. You know, if for countries where the HTA system is inflexible and cannot use this type of data, early access will become a challenge, and therefore this MAPS process probably will get stuck. So I would put out there to start with that may be the place we need to all think about. You know, are there changes that need to be made there?
And if I could challenge you on this. By early access, if in fact by early access we mean a marketing authorization restricted to a very defined population of the first patients where there are evidence that they can benefit, and then the evidence generation continues for other patients to expand the indication, maybe there are some needs to adapt the national rules or to take measures to make sure that the first target population can be treated, but the other patients will be enrolled in the studies to add evidence, which is not always easy to do. When a product is authorized, it's authorized, and prescribers can prescribe it to more or less who they want. So what are the type of policy needs that need to be changed to make sure these processes can be put in place and work as planned? Georg?
Well, James reminded us that you cannot be flexible and rigid at the same time. And I think we can all understand that. So if there are rigidities in national legislation that forbid, for whatever reasons, this kind of flexibility that we need, then this is clearly something that needs to be addressed. I can only speak for the European legislation, sort of that's the universe where I live. I do not think that the European pharmaceutical legislation needs a lot, if any, change to enable this idea of adaptive pathways. I think if we make use of the flexibilities that are in the system, then the system would support us. But there is something else where I see a danger, and it's already been mentioned, I think, by Finn. Nothing to do with HTA or with regulation, and that is the data protection in Europe. We understand, I think most of us understand, we need to learn from data that are out there that fall under the European data protection law. This is, I totally agree with you, the owner of this is the patient. If this is my data, I see myself as an owner. But we have to come to a societal agreement to make these data usable for us. And I would appeal, this is a plea, to the patients' organizations represented in this room. Please make your voice heard, because if European data protection comes to a situation where we cannot use that for learning, then we have lost a huge opportunity. And the only ones who can make that clear to lawmakers, judges, etc., is the patient organizations.
Tim?
I would like to say a few words about, talking about these adaptive processes and the willingness also of the HTAs to be going flexibly into what we, some of us at least, consider to be the future that is here. We will increasingly need to have these adaptive approaches to the new technologies, no doubt about that. But the payers have big problems with this probably. And I will not go into listing a lot of problems with it, but I mean, some kind of preliminary reimbursement. Yeah, we see that in some countries built into agreements, but in not in all countries. So also there will be a lot of things to think about. The thing about legislation, I think it's one or two countries that are struggling with this. I think it's much more general, the thing about the payers. And about the data protection and the issue of who owns the data. If you are admitted into a hospital, at least the doctors, I mean, the providers are actually expected to make records of what they're doing. That's not something the patient can deny. So the data are owned by the patient, but in fact, there are other owners of the data about the patient simply in order to be able to do the job. And in my country, this is interpreted that the system can also use this data for quality assurance, for example. It just needs to be done in a way where the patient is not infringed in any possible way on the secrecy. It can be done. Maybe not if there are some crooks sitting somewhere in the world and spending all their time on breaking into the registers, but generally to a very, very high level it is possible. And this is also, again, we need to have a joint approach to that in order to meet the things that Hans-Geir are asking for.
Sebastian?
Yeah, I think it's, I can only agree with Finn. I think the key issue right now is that we need such coverage with evidence development schemes to ensure that there is payment available, but these should be funded sufficiently so you have a big enough sample size to prove that this technology works and that it's really working in patients. I think beyond that, leave us alone in a way. I think there are so many nice projects coming along right now from the European Commission and elsewhere, and let us do these things until the very end and not start something new again. So I'm really concerned about people being very creative on having new aspects and new things treated and that we should take care of, but I think we should really focus on getting those nice programs to the very end and then evaluate them and then come from pilot to reality. So I think this is the key challenge, and on the policy side, really leave us alone and solve the funding issues, because that's the main constraint for patient access these days.
So that there seems to be a call for stabilization of policy changes. Flora Giorgio from the European Commission.
Thank you. Just since you called for a comment, I think just to share what and to support what Hans-Georg said in relation to this concept of adaptive licensing and the pilots and the flexibility that already exists in the current regulatory framework. I think it's important to underline that. And actually, just last week, the pharmaceutical committee decided to set up a specific expert group really to look at this aspect and to see how this interesting concept that indeed is seen as an inspiring approach that needs to be look more in depth, how this is actually can be implemented, and whether indeed there is any need to adapt the legislation or maybe just better use existing flexibility, and also how this is, can better be reflected in national legislation. So I think that's this work of this group that will start soon, I think will be very inspiring, and together with the result of the pilot in EMA would be very interesting to see the next steps. And in relation to, just to come back on the third question here, where you say about what's need to be done at policy level to complete this and to facilitate this cooperation, I think yesterday with the adoption of this strategy for the HTA network, we already made an important step, and now really the key is getting the strategy into action, as Dr. Marletta was saying at the opening. So I think we are on the right way, and we have all the tools to actually make things progressing. Thank you.
Thank you. I think one of the ideas behind, of the strategy for the long-term HTA cooperation is to propose a vision which by itself will be inviting for HTA agencies and member states to come to the joint work and the sharing of experience without necessarily having to impose mandatory action to make this happen. The, I think the bicycle that Finn showed this morning should be a kind of motivation for all these changes and adaptations to occur. Are there any other views in the room on possible policy changes? Wim?
Thank you very much. I was not here, but I was behind, so, but I have heard each word of what you were saying. And yeah, I know a lot of politicians, and I must say, François, what you are doing, all of you, what you are doing is wonderful. And I would join Hans Georg. If you are going to a politician, he will say, just do it. Just do it. All politicians, and you can, of course, in a lot of levels talk with them and to convince them how important it is. But they will say to you, come on, do it, and we will agree with it. That's my simple thinking.
Thank you. Any other comment or proposal that some of us become politicians? So, where? Ah, right, Nicola.
Nicola Bedlington from the European Patients Forum. Very briefly, as a parenthesis to Hans Georg's point around data protection, the voice of patients, just to highlight that the European Patients Forum is very much involved in a campaign in relation to data protection, just to ensure that the legislation goes in the way that I think all of us in this room wants it to go, just for clarification.
Can I ask patient representatives present in the room if they feel they are strong opposition among patients to have their data easier to be used and accessed by researchers, or if, because this is something where we ourselves have difficulties assessing whether or not patients are more on the protective side or more on the sharing side. And I think it's fair to recognize that there are ambiguous comments from patients. Even the very same person on one side can say, of course I want researchers to have the curiosity to use my data, my blood, my tissues for any research program. On the same side, we hear patients who feel not comfortable when their neighbors can read which patient organization newsletter they receive in their box, in their mail. Some have the impression that when they share their medical history on internet, it's a very remote risk. When they don't perceive the risk to be immediately in their neighborhood, they tend sometimes to minimize the risk of their data being used by others. So all this to say, I think there are mixed views among patients about the sharing of data, but we have a responsibility here to also explain the consequences of these choices. If we start asking for each set of data, do you consent this data to be used for other analyses or other purposes, then first we turn into a huge administrative and unnecessary effort, and second we lose quality as we will lose data. On the other side, if patients don't feel they can trustworthily give their data to their healthcare professionals. There may be some who will simply refuse treatment or refuse some kinds of follow-up at their clinics because they don't want some data to be shared with others. So, so this is a question to other patients. If you feel, if you'd like to share experiences or discussions you had with other patients on these aspects, or healthcare professionals, when you have these discussions with your patients, do you feel there are still strong oppositions of the clinical data or other data to be more easily accessible by researchers, or which way are we going? Wim?
Certainly it does exist. Certainly, there are resistance in some families, in some individuals who are has that resistance you are mentioning. And we must know that, and we all know that, but it is not a big amount of resistance. And it's your duty to explain to them, it's a little bit, now, of course, we must protect your privacy as good as possible, but at the same time, you can explain to them what are the real benefits of a lot of other families, people, and so on. But you will have, but it's not an organized resistance against it, but it really exists.
Another comment quickly, or?
Well, the comment is the following. I'm working on digital data and on exactly what the IP is as at the University of Maastricht. So this is my background, as not as a patient, but at, out of my academic point of view that I'm now telling you something. The IP is actually the point that there is no patient that is resisting to use it for the beggar grow and stuff. But if you go into ethics, between do you give it for the better of the world, everyone will say yes, but it's exactly the nitty-gritty in between where you're getting to the edge where it's going to be, is your data actually used to become a billion words pharma industry medication, as it can be, that your DNA is actually the solution for the rest of the world, and you'll get nothing. So we should talk about, is the IP actually not partly, at least partly, part of the patient and the patient organizations that are taking care of this patient group. So it's not a or no at all. It's an in-between. We should talk about what is the IP. That's the first thing. And from who is it and who has the biggest share, we should at least talk about it. The second thing is data that you give away is actually useless. Useless, I say it again. For the, not for the genomics, but for the phenotype. If you're doing your research on biomarkers, you need more and more specific information of where this information comes from, what the ecosystem is, or actually where this person lives, and you need much more feedback of this certain group that came out of it. So you need much more data of the patient himself and where he lives and what he do extra and stuff to get your research correctly. I was on Thursday, I was in Basel at the compound at Novartis and at Roche. I was talking with researchers and they were saying, yes, we need more of this data and this information of the patient. But that right now we are not getting it just because it's not coming over. So we should not think that the patient is not giving all this information to the physician that is sitting on the other side. But for the research and for the better of the world, the neurotic thing, we also need to know what are these other problems that he's not talking to this physician, but also to other physicians, and what are the other problems that are not even in this medical record. So we should centralize the data around the patient, and this data set, with everything in it, is then worthwhile to be used in the future for research, especially in the pharma industry and actually everywhere else as well. But we shouldn't put it, as you try to bring it, in a yes or no. It is just that we have much more to say about who is the owner of the data, for what is it going to use, for what is it not going to use. Me, myself, as a patient, gave all the information because I was a believer to my physician, and then an insurance company that was looking into my invalidity was actually asking all this data, and then they found two different things that were not exactly the same as what I was giving to them, and I was kicked out of my insurance just for that reason. So be aware from the patient view, yes, I am scared, but of course I'm a believer in the medical thing, but there are some things that we really have to think about as well from a patient view. Thank you.
Thank you. So we are approaching the end of this session. Can I ask the panelists if you would like to add something on one of the three questions on the... Finn, yes?
Yeah, I would actually like to address briefly the question, what are the opportunities for cooperation with HTAs concerning medical devices?
I think that we have some pilots that have actually shown to be quite helpful for many, and there's a talk about that tomorrow morning. Some of the devices that have undergone these pilots, this is now sprinkling into national reporting, you could say. So that, and we have had a meeting in the spring, an expert meeting with the devices industry about methodologies in HTA. I think we should continue this, irrespective of what goes on about the regulation, etc. We should expand on this, clarify more and more what kind of assessment should be done, what kind of data are necessary. So I think we have a street we can walk down.
François?
I just would like to mention how happy I am because of having the possibility to participate in this voluntary cooperation that EUnetHTA has been conducting for now for years. And really, the atmosphere, the relationship are good. We have been now cooperating not only between ourselves, HTA bodies, but also with EMA, and the first steps were not very easy, but that now it's really something that is very fully operational. We have, of course, a lot to do, but if you go again through all the activity stations, you will see how much has been achieved, and I would just to testify the fact that we really do that in a very good spirit, and that we are really good to be supported by our heads of agencies, by the European Commission, by the Secretariat, and what has been done. And I think that this, the number of people being here today reflects this success. And that was my final comment on this topic. Thank you.
Thank you. Other panelists, if you'd like to conclude or have one last? No? Well, then thank you very much for your comments, your responses, your questions. I think it's clear that it's work in progress. Something maybe that doesn't appear is that every time there is an event, there is a consultation, there is a process, there is immediately an evaluation of how this went. For example, for early dialogues, there are questions to the company, questions to stakeholders, as now patients are invited to the early dialogues as well. And from each step to the next step, there will be changes in the procedure because the lessons that are learned at each meeting are immediately implemented in the next meeting. So it's a work in progress with a constant evolution, constant changes. Sometimes it's in the details, for example, how many days before the meeting to receive the documents. Sometimes that can really have a huge impact. The more prepared you are to the meeting, the better. And sometimes just to receive documents earlier makes really a difference. So all this work in progress will continue. We will certainly have more information when more early dialogues, when more guidelines will be open for consultation, where more efforts and registries will be developed and with the involvement of all possible stakeholders. And I think we can conclude this session by saying that it's not exactly the need for policy changes, but to continue all the efforts which are numerous and in various directions, expect the feedback and the highest contribution for all stakeholders. Those who haven't yet joined the EUnetHTA and EMA cooperation activities, please express your interest. I think it's also our role as patient organizations to involve more patients and more organizations to make them aware of the efforts, and the same for healthcare professionals, payers, and other stakeholders. I think the EMA and EUnetHTA are both very open to proposals and contributions on how you think you could play a role in all these activities, not only which ones, but how you think you could contribute to these assessments. Well, thank you again for your participation, and I think now there is a coffee break to come. Thank you.